We begin with our friend Senator John McCain. He's not here tonight as a presidential candidate, but rather as the author of an amazing American bestseller, Faith of My Fathers, a Family Memoir from Random House. Are you surprised at how well it's doing?
I'm astounded. I'm literally astounded.
You thought this kind of military memoir of an upbringing with a father and a grandfather would go nowhere?
I thought it would have some popularity because we put in a lot of time and effort and love into it. But my administrative assistant, Mark Salter, who really deserves the real credit for the book, but to be number two on the New York Times bestseller list obviously surprises me a lot.
You were raised militarily, your grandfather.
Yes.
And you write very honestly of it. What were the minuses of that?
A certain insecurity about moving from one place to another, the breaking up of old relationships, needing to establish new ones. The effect that it had on me was that I had this real and imagined sense that any slight or any disrespect provoked an immediate response, a problem that I have, frankly, to this day. I hope much less. I was small for my age. We moved to a new place. I was going to make sure that everybody understood that I was who I was.
Did you almost have to go military yourself?
Yes. That's why I was so rebellious at the Naval Academy. One of the reasons why I was so rebellious at the Naval Academy. I didn't get the most demerits of anybody who ever went there, Larry, but I was in the top 10, I'm sure. I broke every rule.
You did not take full advantage of your education there?
To say the least. I stood fifth from the bottom of my class. At my graduation, President Eisenhower spoke at my graduation, and he went out of his way to speak to the guy that finished the bottom of our class. I kind of wished I'd done it worse.
And what about your dad? He, like you, had to do it?
I think my dad wanted to more than
he was a better.
He did very poorly at the Naval Academy too.
Record does not reign supreme in Annapolis.
He was devoted to the Navy. He was devoted to his career. He was totally apolitical. He drank too much. He was very brave in World War II. Went through some tremendous experiences as a submarine commander. Was dedicated to the Navy and. There was a time when he was commander-in-chief of U.S. forces in the Pacific where he ordered the bombing of Hanoi. That was his job. It was transmitted from the president. It's very tough on a father to order the bombing of a place where his son is. And I think that was a very great strain on him. But he knew his duty and he didn't shirk it.
Were you aware of it being there?
Yes. Yes, I became aware of it about a year after I'd been in prison.
Wasn't that weird? My father is bombing me?
No, except that I knew that he would do his duty. He couldn't be swayed by any personal concerns. There was a lot of other father's sons who were at risk there who were living in Hanoi, too.
During World War II, you were in school, mm-hmm. high school?
Mm-hmm. Elementary
school. Were you aware of your father in action and all that? And the songs
vaguely.
He used to sing in the morning?
Vaguely, and he was gone so much, you know. In World War II, fathers left. Fathers and husbands left, and they didn't come home till the end of the war.
Why did you choose to fly?
Because I thought it was the most exciting experience that a young person can have.
Not to be different from your father, right? He went down, you went up.
My grandfather had been an aviator. Got his wings very late in his military career and crashed a lot of airplanes. I thought it was the most exciting life that a person could lead. I mean, I used to be almost embarrassed about taking a paycheck because I had so much fun.
Was being shot down partially your fault?
Well, I think I could have probably flown better, but
basically
in those
not,
days,
like you're hit by these.
A surface air missile, yeah. Mm-hmm. I think it was something that we lost three planes that day. And so I think it's one of the risks that you take, although like every other young pilot, I was sure it was never going to happen to me.
It's got to be a weird feeling, though, right? I mean, among life's weird feelings, one would imagine one of the weirdest is to be shot down.
But at that moment of crisis, your training takes over. You don't have time to really think. I was in a very steep dive. The wing came off. The plane was spiraling. My training took over. Saw the plane wouldn't work, eject, and that sort of is the
Scenes in the book are written brilliantly, by the way, of your capture and everything. Mm-hmm. And there's some extraordinary statements, like you're thankful to the Vietnamese.
I thank the Vietnamese for saving my life in that they gave me transfusions.
They could have killed you, right? They could have let you die.
Yeah, but when they were going to do that until they found out that my father was an admiral, and then they decided to help me.
They were brutal, though, were they not?
They were very brutal, and to many of my friends, they were far more brutal than they were to me. And I don't hate the Vietnamese. I don't even have any dislike towards them.
You've met some of your captors.
Exactly. Not any of my guards. I would probably have an emotional response if I did then. But my job has been reconciliation and healing. We still have a lot of old veterans who haven't come home yet, reconciliation and healing. But at the same time, I will never forgive some individuals for the cruelties that they inflicted on some of my friends who were far tougher and far greater men than I.
How long were you held?
5.5 years.
Could have gotten out early, right? Or they offered you that.
They offered me a chance to go home because my father was the commander-in-chief in the Pacific. This would have been a great propaganda coup for them. It wasn't an easy decision, but I had to reject it. That and our code of conduct says that you'll come home in order of shoot down. Everett Alvarez had been there since August of 1964. I came down in October of 67. I couldn't go before Everett Alvarez.
You thought of suicide?
Yes. Tried it, weekly tried it one time when I was badly
broken. You'd
given
up all hope?
Yeah, and I had given in to the Vietnamese and written a confession.
Ashamed of that?
Yes, to this
day.
Why? Because I failed. I didn't to hold out as long as I should have, and many of my friends did, men like Admiral Stockdale and Robinson Reisner.
They laughed at Stockdale. He was some hero, wasn't he?
He was a great American. I
still
regret,
living, of course, but
he is a great
they
American.
Laughed at him in that vice presidential thing with Perot, but...
And I deeply regret that because Admiral Stockdale was not prepared for that scenario. He's an intellect, he has...
teaches at Stanford, right?
He's a marvelous, wonderful man and was a role model and a hero to all of us in the prison experience. And I hope that history... I know that history will judge him that way.
What was day of release like?
A bit euphoric, as you might imagine. It was a remarkable experience. None of us really got excited until the plane was over water from Hanoi, but we conducted ourselves in a military fashion. But the other thing I would like to point out, and I try to say in my book, my great privilege was to serve in the company of heroes. I witnessed 1,000 acts of courage and compassion and love, and it was a spiritually uplifting experience for me in many ways, and those that I love most and respect and admire are those that I was there with.
And of reconciliation, do you understand those who say that Vietnam will be a major tourist area? Mm-hmm. Most of the people going back now are those who fought there.
Many of them go back, bring their children to see the places where they fought. The Vietnamese welcome Americans. You know, they still dislike the French very much and the Russians. I had a meeting one time a couple of years ago when I was back in the MIA POW the issue. General Vo Nguyen Giap, the leader of the Hero of Dinh Binh Phu, meeting with him. He's still a committed Marxist. At the end of our meeting, he said, "You Americans were an honorable enemy." And I think they view us that way, because I know that they know that we didn't go there to try, like the French, to take their country and colonize them. And whether there was the conflict, but they believe that we treated them honorably.
Some thought, even conservative Americans, that Ho Chi Minh could have been the Tito of Asia had we played it differently. In retrospect, you buy that?
I don't know, because when...
He certainly wasn't pro-Russian or pro-Chinese.
No, but the imposition of the communist regime on North Vietnam, and then after what they did, although he had passed away by that time in South Vietnam, was barbaric and cruel. I think he was probably a nationalist, but I think he was also a committed Marxist. It's very hard to say how history would have turned out if we had one of our... You know, without taking any time, we misjudged the nature of the enemy. We were always cautioned by the threat of Chinese or Russian intervention, and that led to a strategy that was doomed to failure.
Honor knowing you, John.
Thank you.
Continued success.
Thank you, sir.